Welcome to the program. This time on Frank Buckley Interviews, it's a conversation with the founder and CEO of a TV maker, maybe the one you're watching us on right now. It's a conversation with William Wang of VIZIO. VIZIO is a leading maker of TVs and soundbars, among other things, but it almost didn't happen. William Wang and VIZIO had to fight off competitors who tried to kill the business, and William had to survive a plane crash that nearly killed him.
The first thing came through my mind was, I'm dead. Something obviously went wrong. I'm dead. Second thought was, I miss all my family. Immediate flashback, all of people around me, my family. And the third thing came through my mind was, how come all my headaches are over? It's like a moment of relief because at that time, I owe a lot of money.
Yeah. How did William Wang survive and thrive?
Frank Buckley Interviews starts now.
William, welcome. It's really a pleasure to have you on the program.
Thank you.
You and I graduated from USC around the same time.
I
went on to become a TV news anchor. You went on to become a billionaire. And it's been a remarkable journey for you to get to this point. And I just wanted to know if we could start with your first job out of USC. And okay. You were making $1,700 a month.
$1,750 a month, yeah.
And you've talked about the fact that you plunged into your work back then.
Yeah.
And that seemed to set the tone for the rest of your working career.
I was such a poor student at USC, and I regret it, actually, because all my friends went on to graduate school, and I never had a chance. So I had to work, and no friends. All my friends were studying, you know, party at school, and I ended up getting a job. Electrical engineer get the highest pay, right? It's like $3,000 average a month, but I couldn't really get a real engineer job. So I worked for this Taiwanese company called Tatung, and I was doing tech support, and it was the only thing I can find at the time.
Even then, starting off on that lowest rung and making $1,750 a month, within, what was it, 3 or 4 years, you were running sales and marketing for the whole company.
Yeah, I was running sales and marketing for that particular division. And that particular division was selling computer monitor to the PC companies.
And you guys were the supplying IBM at the time, right?
Yes.
Your hardware, with your screens.
It was our screen, yeah. We're the supplier for IBM. 12-inch screen monitors.
And you were supplying these monitors, but you found there was something wrong with the monitor that you thought could be changed.
Yes, when IBM first introduced the color monitor, which is supplied by my company at that time, the resolution was really low, and it flickers because its refresh rate is extremely low. I look at it all day long and say, there's no way people can look at it more than a couple hours a day. So I want to build a new spec. I want to build a new monitor, which was better refresh and better frequencies.
Yeah. You went eventually to the chairman of the company and made your pitch, and he said what?
Well, he said no, because they were building a monitor. They were making a lot of money building a computer monitor for IBM. They decided to follow the IBM spec, and he doesn't want to listen to me, so I left.
And how old were you at that time?
26.
26 years old. That takes a lot of chutzpah, right?
Yeah.
To say to the chairman of the company, I know better than you in this case, and I'm taking my idea and going across the street. What gave you the sort of the confidence to do that?
I guess I was still young, and I don't know what I don't know. I just decided this my ideas is better for the consumer. So I'm going to pursue it. So I did that, and I left and started a company building a higher refresh rate computer monitor.
And it eventually took off.
Yeah, it took off quite well and made a lot of money before I was 30 years old, and I built a company out of it.
Yeah, before you were 30, you had made $1 million.
Yeah, before I was 30, I made $1 million. Yeah.
And I'm just curious, for a guy who had a 2.3 GPA at SC in engineering, you described yourself as a loser at that point. The graduate school had rejected you twice.
Yeah.
And now here you are, you're not even 30, you've made $1 million. Did you think, was it sort of, I'll show you, or was there a moment of, maybe I'm not a loser?
Yeah, there was just I got nothing else to do, and I couldn't get a real job. I had no choice, and I believe in myself.
Yeah,
I have pretty good confidence in myself, even though I know I screwed up in college, didn't study hard enough. So this time around, in the professional world, I decided, hey, I want to prove myself that I'm worthy.
And as your company was growing, like many during that era, 1990 into the 1990s, you ran into some difficulty. What happened?
Yeah, around 95, 96, the PC industry really took off, become such a huge business. I mean, back in the 80s, PC was mostly used by professionals and business environment. And around 94, 95, 96, consumers started to buy PC. Mm-hmm. So when the PC industry grew quite a bit, I didn't focus on operation excellency. I didn't focus on building a team. Instead, I was still an entrepreneur, tried to build a better screen, better technology. So I didn't manage the company correctly.
And you were involved in every single detail.
Yeah, which was micromanaged because I was young, I was successful, I made a lot of money. I was pretty arrogant. I never failed in a professional environment. I worked out ever since I got out of college. It was a smooth sailing for me all the way. Mm. And so I ended up paying the tuition later on.
Yeah. In what way?
I lost a lot of money from 96, 97, 98. I lost like $40 million. So I lost $40 million before I turned 40.
Wow. Yeah. You'd made $1 million by the time you turned 30, and you lost $40 million by the time you turned 40.
Yeah.
Coming up.
The captain took the wrong runway, so we hit the construction equipment, and the plane came down. The first thing came through my mind was, I'm dead. Something obviously went wrong. I'm dead.
More of my conversation with William Wang when we come back. You were losing some money. You were stretched.
Yeah.
You owed money to your creditors.
Yeah.
You go overseas to talk to one of your creditors. Tell me what happened.
Well, I went overseas to talk to one of my creditors. Hopefully, he gave me more time to pay off the debt. So I told him, if you want to see me anytime, I'll make it flexible for him. I want to see him because I really want to see him, and hopefully he gave me some more time to pay out the debt. So he told me 3 o'clock. I ended up taking the meeting, and I moved my flight to 11:15 at night. And so I went from China Airlines at 4:30 to Singapore Airlines 11:15.
And you get on the flight, you start down the runway, you hit takeoff speed, the wheels lift off from the runway, and you immediately know something's not right.
Yes, I was in the front of the plane, so we're up like 2 or 3 story high, and I heard this noise, like somebody knocked on the door, like twice, and immediately I leaned to the left, so I know something went wrong. Right? You don't fly into the air leaning all the way to the left, so the plane crashed. The plane hit the construction equipment. Construction barrier, and the runway was closed. So the captain took the wrong runway, so we hit the construction equipment, and the plane came down.
When you were in the middle of crashing, you have some vivid memories of what happened.
Yeah. The first thing came through my mind was, I'm dead. Something obviously went wrong. I'm dead. Second thought was, I miss all my family. Immediate flashback, all of people around me, my family. And the third thing came through my mind was, how come all my headaches are over? This is like a moment of relief because at that time, I owe a lot of money.
Yeah.
I was in Taipei to talk to my creditor. So all of a sudden, I feel a complete relief, believe it or not, that, hey, it's just no more headache. But nothing happened to me. So.
But you had to get out of that plane.
Yeah, so I say, you know, I don't have a lot of patience, right? I say, I'm going to get out of here. The plane was still moving, so I buckled my seatbelt, and I was probably the only guy on the plane running. So I run for the door. I said, I'm going to open that door and get out of there.
Right. And you eventually did, and then you were thrown from the aircraft by the
suction. So it's kind of hard to open that door because the plane was still moving. Eventually, the door blew open. I was really next to the door. I got ejected from the plane. Sort of hot air pushed me out. So I jumped. I was the first guy who jumped out of the plane.
Half of the people who were on that aircraft perished. The other half survived. You were one of a handful of people who didn't suffer any serious injuries. And I wonder, when you experience something like that, is it a moment of, I don't know, survivor's guilt, or is it a moment of clarity, or what happens after you survive such a horrific event like that?
I stand in the rain. It was typhoon that night for like at least half hour. And it was definitely surreal. And I don't have too much memory at that time because I guess my adrenaline was still pumping so hard in the disbelief that this is actually happening to me.
Did it make you think later that I survived this for a reason, or did you read some greater meaning into surviving the plane crash or anything like that?
No, I was just happy to be alive.
What happens next professionally? Because at the moment that plane crash happened, you said that the headaches went away. Did the headaches return?
The headaches is still there. And the creditor feel kind of a little guilty that the reason I was on a flight was because of him. So he ended up giving me a pretty good big break. And he allowed me to do more time to return to that, which is very, until today, I'm very grateful of his action. He's still a shareholder of VIZIO. So, you know, I owe him for life. 2002, I started VIZIO.
And when you start VIZIO, this is something that people must have thought, are you crazy? Because this is a saturated market already. You have the behemoths of the electronics world in that space. And you decide, I'm going to go up against you guys. Why?
Well, I really believe myself. I believe I can make a TV a lot better, at the same time more affordable. And at that time, the flat screen TV was over $10,000. And I know I can build a TV for $3,000 or under. So I know I can. I know everybody in the industry, and I have a lot of good friends in this industry. And they all end up helping me to make my dream come true, which is build a really affordable TV. And again, this was back in 2002. I mean, right now you have a 65-inch TV for like $700-$800, but back then the 65-inch flat screen TV would go for $15,000. I just want to make it affordable. I was a consumer. I'm still a consumer. I want to buy a flat screen TV, but I don't have $15,000 to pay for a TV.
And how did the competitors react to you? Because, as you know, in business, when the big guys see a little guy trying to disrupt their business, they will often try to either buy you or crush you.
Yeah.
Did you experience that?
Well, in the beginning, I don't think my competitor see us as a threat. They think we'll probably go away. A lot of people came in with a cheaper product and tried to disrupt the market, but not a lot of them survived and last. But we did, and we keep on putting the money we made back to the company, building the team, building better technology. So at the time, our competitors don't see us as really as a threat until later on. And then, of course, they try to kill us.
Yeah.
They came out with their intellectual property, tried to sue us, and tried to use price to compete with us. So it's been like that ever since.
Right. And you must have known it was coming. You knew that eventually they would come after you.
Yeah.
How did you prepare for that?
By focus on the fundamental is build a great product at an affordable price. At the same time, build a great team. The team is so efficient that the saving of the efficiency, fund efficiency, is the money we can pass on to our consumers. So we always kept our price low, not because we're buying inferior component. We bought the same component, like Sony and Panasonic. We bought from the same companies that were supplying them. And we spent a lot of money in technology, but at the same time, we tried to be really thrift ourselves. Why we survived until today, which is, it's been 19 years since I started the company, 18 years.
Still ahead.
I think any entrepreneurial company should allow their employee to fail. It sounds it's not crazy. You don't want to fail on purpose, but it's okay to make mistakes. This is how we disrupt this industry. but be more daring.
More with William Wang when we come back. In the conversation about disruption, you have said in the past that you are constantly trying to disrupt yourself as a company, that you're yes. challenging your coworkers and employees to disrupt the company. What yes. does that mean exactly?
Well, you know, we're in the technology world. Every year we come up with new product, new technology. So, for example, when all my friends ask me, what's a good TV to buy? I really don't know what to tell them. I hate that question because it's whatever is on the market today is my work from last year. So I'm constantly trying to think about new thing, and so is my team, right? Come up with a new thing that new technology can help consumer to live a better life. Streaming, for example, we were the first company who put streaming onto the TV way before this whole thing about Netflix is hot and OTT is the future. In 2007, 2008, we came up with the first smart TV was a streaming platform. We're constantly looking at more things to make consumers' life better. It's been like that since day one.
You've learned from the period where you failed, where you said you were micromanaging too much. You now have a massive company with that is the market is the world now for VIZIO. And I just wonder, how do you do it with the employees? Do you give them permission to fail? What is the charge that you give to them to say, go out and disrupt this very company?
Well, first of all, I want everybody to focus on the fundamental, what we believe in. And also, second, you allow them to fail. I think any entrepreneur company should allow their employee to fail. It sounds it's not crazy. You don't want to fail on purpose. But it's okay to make mistakes. For my employees, it's okay for them to make mistakes, but just don't make, you know, stupid mistake, and don't make mistake twice. So this is how we disrupt ourselves. This is how we disrupt this industry, by more be more daring, take on more risks, accept the possibility of mistake, and but move on and learn from it.
And in terms of VIZIO and where VIZIO goes in the next 5 or 10 years. Are you in an expansionist mode? Are you going to start acquiring other people? Are you going to be acquired? Are you going to go public? What can you share in those regards?
Yeah, again, 5 years is a long time in our business. We're going to continue to be more aggressive, try to put more technology into use so people's consumers' life will be easier. I mean, we just launched, for example, Apple AirPlay into our TV, so now you can look at your photo, share your photo with the family on a big screen TV. It's kind of technology, it's just more innovation, I would say. More innovation connecting the TV into not just cable setup box, but into multiple different devices. And if we need to acquire a company, we will, to make the consumer lives better. But the innovation will continue. We want to be the leader in this industry, especially in today's internet era. We want to bring TV into the 21st century.
And you've certainly done that. You've become one of the leaders in TV manufacturing. And when you got into this space, people were betting against you. Does it give you great satisfaction to know that you're one of the top guys in the industry now?
There's always more battle to fight. I don't look at it that way. I think, you know, we're pretty fortunate to be here, but there's still the number one spot we're looking after. And so we still have a lot of work to do. And we're certainly not gonna stop here. So I'm not looking at ourselves and say, oh, we made it so far. You know, it's just a lot of work we need to do to make TV even better.
Last question on a personal basis. As someone who graduated from USC with a 2.3, who was rejected from the engineering school for grad school, to be invited back in 2011 to be the commencement speaker at the engineering school, and to be where you are today, did you expect it? Did you know in your heart, even though that maybe on paper it wasn't meant to be, did you always know that you would be where you are today?
I don't know. I don't know one way or another. You know, I don't know we're going to be number one, number two in the TV space, but I don't know I'm not going to be number one, number two in the TV space. Mm. And I know I didn't do a good job in college, so I say I'm going to come back, right? So I don't give up. I think it's my business model that I never give up. If I fail, I stand up again. It's okay to fail as long as we have another chance. I'm fortunate enough to have second chance. Business in school, going back to do the commencement speech for the graduate school engineer was such a flattering honor, and I had a second chance in life. So I don't give up in life, and as long as I'm around, I'm going to make my life better and everybody else's life better around me. So,
well, we'll leave it on that note to William. Thank you so much for this pleasure.
Thank you.
If you'd like to hear more of my conversation with William Wang, check out the Frank Buckley Interviews podcast. It's available everywhere, and of course, it's always free to listen. Thanks for the feedback on social media. Tag me at Frank Buckley TV. I read all of your comments. And don't forget, you can always see all of our shows on demand on YouTube. Just search for Frank Buckley Interviews. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.